The benefits of solar energy are obvious. I don't think anyone can argue that it's not amazing to generate your electricity from the power of the sun. But the biggest question is often cost. Will the savings you gain from solar really pay for the cost of installing the system in the first place? And even more secondary questions come up, like, are they difficult or expensive to maintain? How long do they last? Will they work where I live? Those are all questions I hear a lot. So let's dive into this. I started looking into solar about 5 years ago, but two things were holding me up: cost and shade. Those two are tightly intertwined when deciding if a solar system is right for you. You need to be able to generate enough solar energy to help offset the cost of the system. The ideal setup for solar and panels in the Boston area where I live is a southern-facing roof at an angle of about 42 degrees. My house faces east to west, but with the latest panels, it still works just fine. On top of that, my house is wedged into a sea of tall, old trees that cast a lot of shade in the afternoon. It's not a good recipe for solar. Well, 3 or 4 years ago, we had to remove some trees because they were dying, and then two separate storms, we had a couple of more trees fall. So our roof ended up getting a lot more sun, which meant that solar became a viable option. This one's a little tough to answer because it really depends on where you live. There are different state and federal tax rebates or credits that may be available to you, as well as special solar loans and incentive programs. These can have a profound impact on the overall cost of the system and the payback period that you're looking into, as well as your kilowatt hour energy costs in your area. I used a free service called EnergySage to help me calculate the rough cost of the system in my area, along with those rebates, as well as helping me to find a good reputable solar installer. I was so happy with my EnergySage experience that I've joined their partnership program and have an Undecided portal that you can visit to research cost and installers for yourself. They're a vendor-neutral resource that was partially funded by the Department of Energy to improve the customer experience when researching and shopping for solar. And they run the most visited solar website in the country. Their marketplace gets you online quotes from pre-screened installers in your area at 10 to 20% lower prices. I'll include a link in the description. To be completely transparent though, this is an affiliate program for my channel, so if you research and find an installer using EnergySage through my portal, it helps to support the channel. It's a completely free service, which I've used myself, and I can vouch for how much it really helped me through the whole process. And whether or not you use my EnergySage portal doesn't matter. I strongly recommend EnergySage for your research and questions. So let's break down the exact costs of my system. I had 26 LG panels with microinverters installed for a 9.49 kilowatt DC system at a cost of $29,609. It's pricey. My system is eligible for the federal solar tax credit, which will reimburse up to 30% of that cost. And a quick note on the federal solar tax credit, starting in 2020, the residential credit will drop to 26% and 22% in 2021, and by 2022 it will be gone. So if you want to take advantage of the program, you only have a couple of years left. And if you want to get the full 30%, you have to do it in 2019. In addition to the $9,883 we'll get back from the tax credit, we're also benefiting from the SREC program, which is the Solar Renewable Energy Certificate program, which is paid out by the energy market for how much your solar system puts back into the grid. For that, we opted for a fixed monthly price versus the variable quarterly price because it made more sense for our current situation. In the end, it's $126 a month for 10 years, or a grand total of $15,146. SRECs aren't available in all states, but many states offer other types of rebates and incentives. And then there's still the straight-up savings in energy usage when you have a solar system installed. You should also be getting a net meter that replaces your standard electric meter. It's basically a meter that can roll forwards and backwards depending on if you're pulling energy from the grid or if you're adding back to it. When your system is producing more energy than you currently need, the surplus is going back into the grid. That means your meter is running backwards, essentially banking that energy for you to pull from later. On my system, it's projected to generate about 6,600 kilowatt hours per year, or roughly 60% of my yearly usage. That's an estimated $1,400 a year in savings on my electric bill. And one quick side note, any reputable solar installer should provide you an accurate estimate on energy production over the course of 10 to 20 years, which will also take into account the degradation of the panel efficiency. They should also provide you with some kind of energy guarantee. My installer guarantees at least 95% of the estimated production, or they'll cover the difference. So that's $19,000 for the whole system after the 30% tax rebate, and factoring in around almost $3,000 a year through electrical savings and SRECs. That means the system will pay for itself in about 6 years and 8 months. That's assuming I paid for the system upfront in total, which I didn't. we went with a private 10-year solar loan through Avidia Bank, which has an interest rate of 5.99%. Taking that interest into account and the system will have paid for itself in maybe 9 to 10 years. That's on a system that's warrantied for 20 years and can be expected to last 25 years or more. Depending on your annual household income, there may also be special low or no interest solar loans available to you. For me, so far, on a monthly basis, it's about the same out-of-pocket cost as I had before solar. $150 loan payment offset by $126 SREC check and lower energy costs from the grid. In the summertime, I'll see that get even better, and once the loan is paid off, it starts to turn into major savings. That means I'll be saving about $120 per month, or about $1,400 a year, from around year 9 onwards. But it will most likely be more than that because energy prices have been rising about 2-3% each year in my area. And I can already hear the comments. You'll never get that back if you move out of your house before you recoup the cost of the system. Yeah, to that, you'd be right if I was leaving my house in a year or two. However, if you finance and pay for the system yourself and don't lease it, adding solar to your home actually increases your home's value by 3-4%. You'll often see about a $4 per watt of the installed solar system added to your home's value. Now, while I'm not expecting and counting on that, it's nice to know that I should be seeing a sizable increase on my home's value when I go to sell it. From start to finish, it took about 3.5 months to get my solar installed at my house. That sounds kind of bad, and it does need to get faster than that, but it was fairly straightforward and painless process. Most of the time in the beginning was talking to different solar installers, selecting one, hammering out the details of the size and the type of the system, and signing a lot of contracts and agreements. Once we had a contract signed, it took about 2 months before our installer had an opening to install the system. The actual install took 1.5 days, and we were extremely happy with the professionalism and workmanship of the team. All photovoltaic systems are generating DC current, which has to get converted into AC. There are three methods to do this: string inverters, microinverters, or power optimizers. The most common are the last two. String inverters operate like old-fashioned Christmas tree lights. If one panel stops producing electricity, then all the panels in that string stop producing electricity. Microinverters and power optimizers don't suffer from that and can keep generating electricity from other panels. If you're on a string or power optimizer setup, you'll typically have a centralized inverter located somewhere on the outside of your house. This is where the change from DC to AC occurs before moving into your electrical meter and then finally your panel. For mine, there wasn't a centralized inverter because there are microinverters on each panel, but there's a centralized cutoff for the system. If anyone from the electric company or emergency services need to shut off the system for any reason, it's as simple as flipping one switch on the outside of the house. The flow continues from a meter into the electrical panel on a dedicated circuit, which means there's a second place I can disconnect the system. The outside switch cuts off the system from everything, and the inside switch cuts off the solar system from the house only. After the install, it was a waiting game for the electrical and structural inspections, and for the energy company to approve the system and switch us out for the net meter. The solar installer took care of all the paperwork and permits, so all we had to do was wait. In the very beginning of October, we got a call that the system was approved to be turned on, and I actually got word as I was on my first big Tesla road trip, which I made a video on. If you're interested, I'll include a link down below. As excited as I was to turn the system on, it was a gray and rainy day, which kind of made the whole thing anticlimactic. This is where I'm going to have to do a follow-up at the 6-month mark and the 1-year mark. The system has only been up and running for a little over 3 months, and it's during the time of year where production is the absolute lowest. We're in the middle of winter with the least amount of sun, and even when the sun is up, it's very low in the sky. In the very beginning of October, I was seeing days between 10 kilowatt hours and 17 kilowatt hours, but December it's been bouncing around 1.5 to 6. It's important to look at the total production on a monthly and yearly basis and not get bogged down in the day-to-day. So looking at the monthly totals I have so far, in October, 239.85 kilowatt hours, November, 114.27 kilowatt hours, and December, 90.52 kilowatt hours. That works out to about $100 in electricity savings in 3 months, which is nothing to write home about, but those numbers will look radically different when we get into the spring and summertime. And if anyone's interested, I can do a follow-up later in the year. As I mentioned earlier, I started looking into solar about 5 years ago, and it's surprising how much the prices have improved in a matter of a few years. One of the first quotes I got about 3 years ago was for the same price as the system I just had installed. but it was only a 5.8 kilowatt system, but the new system has a 40% increase in the energy production due to the higher efficiency panels that are available now. The price per watt for solar systems has been dropping dramatically over the past 8 years due to the more efficient panels, cheaper inverter costs, installation costs, and various other factors. EnergySage is seeing about a $3 per watt right now for residential installations. If you look at the utility scale energy plans and factor the cost to generate 1 megawatt of electricity, solar is now cheaper than gas, coal, and nuclear. Now, the biggest challenge with solar energy is storage. Our energy grids generate the exact amount of energy needed at any given moment. That means they constantly have to ramp up and down how much energy they're generating over the course of a day to match the demand. They don't produce a surplus because there hasn't been a good solution for mass energy storage. Mismanage the production versus demand, and you could end up with blackouts. The obvious benefit to coal, gas, and nuclear plants is that they can operate 24 hours a day, while a solar array is only generating during the daylight hours. But during those daylight hours, PV systems can generate an incredible amount of energy for very low cost. That's where energy storage comes in, which not only helps with renewable energy production sources like solar, but it can also help manage peak load. Some energy companies have been using dammed hydroelectricity to store energy production. They use surplus energy to pump water into a reservoir at a higher elevation, and when they need to release the stored energy, they open a dam to let the water flow back down to a lower reservoir to generate the power. Other systems are doing similar things, with rail cars being moved up and down an 8-mile section of inclined track. But the most promising system of storage is battery packs, because they're highly efficient in storing and releasing the energy. If there's a sudden peak in energy demand, battery packs can release that power in a matter of milliseconds. The end result for systems like all of these is a more responsive and adaptable grid, which helps to create more stable pricing. Tesla has shown how well these battery power stations can perform in Australia. They installed a $66 million battery pack system that is designed to replace peaker plants and has reportedly saved 90% in grid service cost. In the first 6 months of operation, it made up about $17 million in savings. Systems like this, dams, and hauling weights to store power are opening the door to better managing our electrical systems. And they open the door to more reliance on renewable energy sources like solar, wind, and hydro. We can store the massive surpluses they create and use storage to release that energy when we need it. For your home, there are similar battery pack options that you can get. There are products like Tesla's Powerwall, LG Chem's RESU battery, Nissan, BMW, and more are all getting in on the action. Whether or not a whole home battery makes sense for you is another tricky calculation. For me, my solar system isn't producing enough energy to truly take advantage of a battery system. And if I went onto a battery, I'd lose the financial benefits of the SREC monthly payback I'm getting. If you live in an area that doesn't have SRECs and also has time of use energy rates, which means you're paying less for your nighttime energy versus your daytime energy, you'd probably be a great candidate for a battery system. Getting a solar system installed in your roof or as an array in your yard is definitely an expensive proposition. There's a lot to factor in, like how long you expect to stay in your home. Do you have enough space on your roof or in your yard for an array? And will the energy generation help the system pay for itself? It's a very personal decision with a lot of variables, but I was surprised by how much energy we're able to generate off such a small roof in a less than ideal location. My system will pay for itself in less than 10 years, adds to my home's value, and helps to offset charging my EV. For me, it was a no-brainer. Now, if you're someone who's interested in going green but don't own your own home or aren't a good candidate for solar, there are still ways you might be able to make changes. Some areas allow you to select your energy source. Here in Massachusetts, you can select an energy supplier, so you could choose a company that's 100% green. Some areas also have programs to do an energy audit of your home and help you make changes to improve its energy efficiency. Again, here in Massachusetts, we have a program called Mass Save, which will do just that and even offer rebates to help you pay for it. You might have to do some digging, but your local governments and agencies may be able to help. And finally, be sure to check out my EnergySage portal for researching solar, calculating costs, payback periods, and any other questions you might have. They're a tremendous resource and completely free. You can plug in your information and get requests from pre-screened solar installers, which all get funneled into your EnergySage account. You don't have to worry about getting flooded with phone calls. It makes it easy to compare installers, cost estimates, and energy production quotes in one place. And installers also have customer rankings and feedback, so you can find a reputable and good quality installer. If you like the video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and comment below if you have solar and how it's been working out for you, or if you're still thinking about it and have questions that I didn't cover. I'm sure there are a lot of people out there that can provide some good details and suggestions from their experiences too. And don't forget about the limited edition Tesla wall connector giveaway I'm running right now. The giveaway is available in the United States and Canada and is running until March 8th at 11:59 p.m. Eastern time. So be sure to get your entries in before then. I'll announce the winner on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and here on the channel's YouTube community tab. If you'd like to support the channel, there are some ways that you can do so. Want some fun, geeky t-shirts? I have an SFSF shop that includes some cool Tesla, SpaceX, science, and video game designs. Some custom Undecided channel prints are also on the way. Every purchase helps to support the channel, so be sure to check out the link in the description. You can also become an Undecided supporter on Patreon to help grow and shape the channel. On Patreon, I post updates, polls, behind-the-scenes content, and look to that group to help me decide what's coming next and how to shape the channel and the community. If you're interested, please go check out my Patreon page for additional details, and I hope to see some of you over there. And a special big shout out to one of the new Supporter Plus members, Tom W. Thanks so much for joining and supporting the channel. There are also some Amazon affiliate links in the description for items that you might find useful. And if you haven't already, consider subscribing and hitting the notification bell to get alerts when I post new videos. And as always, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.